Welcome to the lecture. So this is another chapter, and that corresponds to the next chapter in the algorithmic game theory book. So it's about network formation games and potential function method as a tool for those games. So we already have seen this method. Potential functions minima represent the equilibria, and in general, more generally, the changes in the utility of the deviating player are equal to the changes in the potential in those points, strategy. But that's just a tool we will see. So basically, it's about network formation games, unlike the previous chapter, which was about network routing. When a network exists, let me just think how to route. So the basic idea is that you have self-interested agents, which usually are in control of parts of the network. Not necessarily that an agent is associated with a node. Sometimes an agent can control several nodes. And they want to form efficient networks by interconnecting. Now, they want to increase the quality of token, generally speaking, the connection and the network, and to minimize their costs. So the utility of an agent basically is a trade-off between those quality and minus cost. And now, for example, one simple example that we have seen, that's something we saw on the second lesson. It was on the third. It was the Chaplin network design game. And they needed to connect sources to the things, and we also found an example where the best Nash equilibrium, the only Nash equilibrium, was a harmonic factor away from the optimum, so price stability. The anarchy also, price stability even was very large. So in that case, in the Chaplin case, they need to construct a network. And you would pay for an edge, your share, so the cost of an edge, divided by the number of pairs to use the edge. You need to connect yourself to your sink, and to minimize the cost. That's what you need. Now, an application can be interconnecting network, internet, where you have autonomous systems which operate the internet, and each of them wants to connect but to minimize its costs. And there are also practical actual roads where cars go. So also there are organizations who basically want to pay roads, and constructing a road costs something. So you want to minimize your costs, but you need to have a nice network. So now we're going to get deep into some classes of the game, namely the three classes, and I'm going to try in general lines, and the potential function method, right, introduction, but it's kind of continue something we saw at the previous chapter, which helps us, so that the method helps analyze the issue. In the previous chapter, we also used the method to prove the existence, for example, of equilibrium. So, an important difference from the previous class of games, I mean, from the network routing game, is that first here the agents seek to increase the quality and to minimize the cost, so the utility is not merely how much you, not merely one thing. And I mentioned it's one function, but this function is considered from some which represent the quality of your experience minus something which represents how much you pay, instead of just the cost. And here, the quality can represent distance. You want to be closely connected, or you want to be generally well connected, rather than just the congestion saw in the previous chapter. And anyway, there you paid for the congestion. You didn't have any other costs. So you have only, there you had this minimized congestion. Here you want to improve, maximize quality and minimize the path, the price, costs. Yeah, the utility is kind of a trade-off of several of two terms. And that's a difference. There is a difference in that sense. And also the congestion was something you wanted to minimize, whereas the quality you want to maximize. But actually, that's not necessarily the case, because it can be that the quality is the minimum. In the case it's a distance, you should want to minimize the distance. For example, to all the other nodes. So the actual difference from the routing games is that simply the quality is something differently defined, and there is that thing which we call the how much it costs. Whereas in the previous chapter, you just wanted to minimize congestion. And here it's also important that usually in network formation games, people assume that the edge is formed only if both sides want to form it, and therefore the stability concept is so-called pairwise Nash equilibrium. Excuse me, pairwise stability, which means that, which tells basically that the situation is stable if and only if nobody can unilaterally delete something, and no pair would like to connect can connect it. So you allow pairs to collaborate on interconnection. Now here we'll assume that a Nash can be made unilaterally, and therefore we just use Nash equilibrium. There is no need in a pair, no basic need in collaboration, therefore we just use Nash equilibrium. Of course, we can still talk about, okay, what if a group starts collaborating and all that, but the basic concept we use is Nash equilibrium. I'm talking about just what we do here in our discourse in this chapter. I'm not talking about the general models, because general models, as I said, they often assume that you need both sides to interconnect, and then they use pairwise stability, which we may actually touch upon in the course if we have time. So the agenda is as follows: three major subclasses of this network formation game. First, local connection game by Fabricant et al. From 2003. As you see, these are quite fresh models. Not like really fresh from yesterday, but still from our century. So they want to minimize the costs, and each node is associated with is simply a place associated with a node, and they want to pay less for the edges they construct while having a short pass to everyone else. And that can model establishing social relationships, establishing peer-to-peer subnetwork, or several subnetworks connecting among themselves, establishing a larger network. So that's something like that. Another thing, I also can think of a road network where you just want to, several cities can need to interconnect, they need to interconnect. And let's say that only one city pays for the connection. One city decides, okay, I will make the road to another city, I will pay for the connection, but both cities enjoy from this road. That's also something which can be modeled here. Another class is the global connection game. So that's actually, I'm not sure. I think this is the first paper where actually the words came, price of stability were used. So the price of stability, I'm not sure 100%, but I think this is actually the first paper which actually explicitly used the words price of stability. Unlike the local connection one, each player was a node who just needs to connect itself. Here, a player can control several nodes, and a player needs to connect some groups of nodes to some group of nodes. The player has a general mission, that's why it's called global. And here, we also call it, we assume the distance doesn't matter, just a player needs to connect a subset of nodes. The player is kind of assigned the subset which she needs to connect. And just she needs to make it as cheaply as possible, where we assume fair cost sharing, so all the nodes who use edge pay an equal share, and that most constructions of large networks, where we just I can construct those nodes, those rows, you can construct those rows, or I connect us here, you connect us there, globally, so it's not like that everyone only connects. And here we use the potential function method to find the price of stability. By the way, that's something which often helps for you to find the price of stability. And now the last subclass we will touch here, we'll touch upon the facility location games. For example, the following the work by Vetta from 2002, also from our extension. So we want to minimize the profit, to maximize the profit here. The profit is the income from the customers for whom I make those facilities minus the costs for me. So I need to minimize what I pay for the facilities and maximize what I get as an income from the customer and from the clients. So the connection requirements are not like just connect, but rather get connect so that you have the maximum income. And you want to maximize the profit. So we will show that the price stability is one, which means that there is an optimum stable state. And also we bound the price of hierarchy. And in addition to those measures which talk about Nash equilibria, we will find some bounds on what is the social welfare after a long selfish play. So this best response, kind of, not necessarily what we did. The best responding thing. And when we have not yet achieved an equilibrium, but we have been playing and we have been improving, hopefully, the social cost. In the sense of decreasing the cost, but improving the cost. Okay, so this is the three topics, an overview. And now let's go into the first topic, into the local connection game. So the model is that you have a node and a place. That's just a game. They want to connect to other players, so the strategy set of a player, we now define the game. Eventually, we'd like to understand the efficiency of the equilibrium of Nash equilibrium of the game. So the strategy set of player I is defined as all the subsets of the set of all the connections of player I to other player. So the strategy is a subset of edges from player I to other player. Strategy can be, I connect to players 3, player 1 connects to players 2, 7, and 8. That's a strategy. So a strategy is a subset of this set. 2 to the power of a set means the set of all subsets. That's the power set. So a strategy is a subset of those sets, the set of edges. Maybe it's an empty set. So a player can say, I don't want to connect to anyone. That's my strategy. Now, given strategy profile, let the graph resulting from the strategy profile be the graph from those nodes. And simply all the edges in this strategy profile created by some of the players I use. Well, the resulting graph does not depend on who actually creates the edge. Now, do you know the distance between the players in the graph to be the shortest path between those players in the resulting graph? And if there is no path between them at all, then it's infinite. So each player is motivated to connect to everyone, not necessarily directly, but you need to be connected. So the graph needs to be connected in the equilibrium. So the final thing we need to define to define again, it's the utility of a player. And the utility of player I, given a profile, for S is the cost of all the edges player I construct. And the cost is alpha for every edge for each player. uniform plus the total distance. So I want to minimize the cost of what she has constructed plus the total distance. So the distance to all the edges is the distances are weighted plus one, so there is no preference among them to whom you want to connect. You just want to be connected to everyone in the same the same extent. So there is no weight here before the distance. And you pay for each edge the same. Now, please notice that basically alpha implies the trade-off, the weight with which you weight, how much you don't want to pay. So if alpha is very light, it means that the players really care about not paying too much. If alpha is small, it means that the players don't care about how much they pay, they just really want to minimize their. Intuitively speaking, when the alpha gets to be smaller and smaller, the table states will probably be more and more connected. Less and less important for the players to avoid payment for the connection. Now, in Nash equilibrium, at most one node of each couple connects them, because it will connect them and there is no motivation for the other one to connect. If two nodes connect, it means that both of them, each one of them, can unilaterally improve their equilibrium. In another remark is that in Nash equilibrium, as we said, the connected graph arises. Because otherwise, some player pays an infinite price, and by connecting to all the nodes by herself, she can make a price final. Now, we call a graph stable. Well, first of all, this is a normal form game, so a Nash equilibrium is just defined as usual for a normal form game that nobody can strictly improve by deviating unilaterally. Now, another thing, you know what is the stable profile of such strategies. Now, which graph do we call stable? A graph is stable if there is a stable profile, if there is a Nash equilibrium, in other words, such that the graph is the result of this Nash equilibrium. And we define the total cost as the total cost or total utility. Please pay attention that the players want to minimize their utility. So I would like, I should define this as a cost, because the players want to minimize the cost of construction minus cost of the distance. You want to minimize that. So I should actually change that. The total cost is indeed the sum of the distances, where for each couple you calculate twice, because each member of the couple pays for that in the cost, plus the sum of the total construction of points. Good, you want to minimize that. So now you would like, after we've defined it, you would like to study what are the efficiencies of equilibrium. Now, so we study a simple case of certain optimal graphs. And then, so graphs which minimize the first cost. Then we study what are certain stable graphs. I remind you, a graph is stable if there is net energy equilibrium, which results in the graph. And that will allow us to bound the price of stability from the bar. Say that at least it's as bad. Never it's most as that bad. And the price of anarchy will need some other techniques. So the graph is called optimal or efficient, you know, if a social cost is just the minimum possible. Now, since here is finite, the number of strategies and strategy profiles are finite, of course, this exists, the minimum exists. Now, the first lemma is very simple. It simply says the following. Now, if alpha, this parameter, which tells how much you don't want to pay for contractions, is this too intuitively speaking, that means that they don't really want, they are kind of stingy, they don't really want to pay. And then any star is optimal. So you don't really want to be strongly connected. One guy connects everyone, and that's all. On the other hand, if alpha is at most two, so they don't mind paying so much, then the complete graph is optimal. Please notice, we don't say these are the only optimal, and these are often not. We just say that these are optimal. So proof, the proof is simple, just a simple combinatorial consideration, or even simple strategic consideration, one might say. So consider graph G, that would be optimal. Now denote the number of edges in the graph by M. Cumulative means that it's connected. Therefore, the number of edges is at least N minus 1. Otherwise, we'll have at least someone not connected. Now, there exists N minus 1 minus 2 M pairs, which are not directly connected. Because the number of pairs is N times N minus 1, the number of connections is 2M, of connected, directly connected classes is 2M, so there exists this number of non-directly connected couples, so within those couples, the distance is at least 2. Now, the social cost, therefore, is the following. The cost is the cost you pay for the connections, so it's alpha times M. Then it's twice the number of, it's twice, I remind you a bit, the possible connections, plus the distances each counted twice from each pass point of view. So those non directly connected, those n times n minus 1 minus 2n, each incurs the 2 is because each incurs at least 2, because the distance is at least 2. We do count the fact that this is twice counted from the point of view of each player is already expressed in this number. So we look at how many pairs, and a pair can be counted both like 1 and 3, say, and 3 and 1. So for those, the distance is at least 2. And the rest, 2m, the distance is exactly 1. So these are the distance, this is the minimum of the distances, and this is the, this is alpha m is the cost. And that's the number. Now, this number is matched by stars and by the complete graph. By any star and by the complete graph. So those are those are minimum from the point of view of social cost. Now, we also would like to minimize the social cost by choosing the right M, because given an M, each star and each, the complete graph, they are all minimized. But which M do we need to choose? So the M needs to be minimum when alpha is larger than 2, because then M is multiplied by something positive, and then M has to be star, minimum from M, N has to be maximum when alpha is smaller than 2, because then it's maximized, because then it's, okay, I'm confused. M has to be minimum, because when alpha is larger than 2, then M is multiplied by something negative, so it needs to be minimized. Yeah. And then we just choose a star, and that's a minimum number of edges which can be in a connected graph. So a star minimizes the expression, and Alistair minimized inspiration and Parker regret and then too. Also, the M is the M which minimizes this, so it's going to be really the minimum. Now, when alpha is smaller than 2, then alpha minus 2 is positive. We would like to maximize M, and therefore we would like to choose the complete graph. Because, okay, the expression is attained by both any star and the complete graph. But the complete graph maximizes the expression when alpha is smaller than 2 and the star and any star minimizes. Okay, we have shown that any star is optimum when alpha, for those alpha any star is optimal, and for those alpha the complete graph. Okay, next. We also show that luckily we can obtain stars in complete graphs as Nash equilibria. They can be actually, so in other words, they can be stable. They can be a result of Nash equilibria. It's a bit different parameter. So they have a divide, the watershed was on 2. Here it's on 1. And therefore it's going to be not exactly the same. So it's not going to be like the parametric stability is always 1, because there will be this gray intermediate area between 1 and 2. But okay, let's now prove the lemma. So first of all, let's formulate. When alpha is at least 1, any star is in Nash equilibrium. When alpha is at most 1, then the complete graph is in Nash equilibrium. And so let's prove alpha is at least 1, then consider any star. So without loss of generality, let's assume that the player one connects to everyone else, and the rest don't do anything. And then player one won't deviate, because if he deviates, he will still be connected. It will strictly increase his utility from something finite to something infinite. It will strictly increase my cost. Any leaf player, so any other player, can add some number of edges. But if she has some number k of edges, or k edges, and that would save k in distance, instead of going through the center, it's going to be 1 instead of 2. But so it will be closer by 1 to k left, but it will cost alpha times k. And since this is the case where alpha is at least 1, the cost will be at least as high as the gain, so it's not going to be pretty profitable. So this is an Nash equilibrium. And therefore the resultant star is a stable. See, now that alpha is most 1, consider the complete graph with some assignment of edges to one of the incident players. Yeah. Because you can decide, okay, this player actually builds edge between 1 and 5, can be assigned to either 1 or 2 5. Some assignment will do. Any such assignment will be an equilibrium, because stopping constructing k edges would say that, so take any player, assume that he stops constructing some of the edges she makes, let's say some k, the number k of edges. Now, that would save her alpha times k for not constructing them, but it will increase her total utility, her total cost by k, because with those k, she will need now to go through any neighbor. Assuming there is some neighbor, it will be on a path of 2, but it's going to still be a path of length 1 more than it used to be, so it will increase it by k. Of course, if there is no neighbor possible connecting them, it's going to be infinite, and then there is no question that it's not going to be a profitable deviation. But even as is, it saves alpha k, and alpha is at most 1, so it saves less when it costs k. So it's not a profitable deviation. It's also Nash equilibrium, and we have proven the lemma. Now, we conclude. Something about the price of stability. Just before we do it, please notice that there exists also less efficient equilibrium. Just so that, okay, those are equilibrium, and those are efficient. But there is sufficient equilibrium. So we don't say here anything about the price of anarchy. But what we can say is something about the worst price of stability. And that is that if alpha is at least 2 or at most 1, then the two lemmas immediately tell us that the price of stability is 1. Because we know that for those values, the star, if it's at least 2, then the star is in Nash equilibrium and it can be it's also optimum. And if it's less than 1, then the coupling graph is optimum and it's also Nash equilibrium. Not necessarily the only one, but it's in Nash equilibrium. In both cases, we will have for both ranges of alpha, we will have an equilibrium graph which is optimum. And therefore, the parasitic stability will be 1. Now, the other thing is that alpha, in the other cases, when alpha is strictly between 1 and 2, then we only say that the price of stability is at most 4 thirds. Why? Because if alpha is strictly between 1 and 2, in the open segment 1 and 2, and any star is in Nash equilibrium, as we've seen, whereas the complete graph is optimal, that's what we know. Now, the ratio bounds the price of stability from above. That's the worst price of stability. And the worst case of this ratio can take place. I mean, the worst alpha is when alpha approaches 1 from the right. And that would determine this ratio, which is equal to this, which is always strictly smaller than 4 or 3. Okay. We are done, and the next stop will be the price of anarchy.